Welcome to lecture number 15 of the course Introduction to Data Science. In the last two lectures, we spoke about process mining. This is the type of data that is using the fact that there are timestamps and that there are events that are ordered in some way. So these are data that have specific characteristics. In this lecture, we are going to focus on text mining. There will be two lectures devoted to it. And just like process mining was focusing on temporal data, we now focus on textual data and try to use and exploit the specifics of text to create, let's say, a wide range of data science problems. So what we will do today is that we will focus on the definitions and preliminaries. What is NLP? What is text mining? And then we will mostly talk about text pre-processing, and we will end with that we are able to represent the text in a way that you can already see that one can apply all kinds of data mining techniques to it. So we will turn documents into vectors that can be used for information retrieval, but that can also be used to create decision trees, to do clustering, etc. So we are moving away from tabular data, as we have seen before, to unstructured text. But what you will see is that in the end, also this unstructured text, we will try to turn that into vectors that we can, for example, feed to a neural network. Okay, in principle, like also the other lectures, the slides should be somehow self-explanatory with combined with this lecture. However, if you would like to read more, there are of course, let's say, many books going much deeper into the field of text mining. And here are some, let's say, recommended readings. But strictly speaking, this would not be necessary. Okay, let's start with some high-level definitions. Of things that you may encounter when people talk about text mining or NLP. So text mining looks at the extraction of knowledge from unstructured text. And text is what we know, that is what is in books, that is what is in articles, that is what is on websites, that is what is in Trump's tweets. All of these things are text, and we understand very well what text is. But text has specifics. For example, a text is composed of words. We have things like verbs and nouns. So we will exploit, let's say, this structure and let's say show how text mining is dealing with these things. So this is the text mining pipeline that we will use, let's say, throughout this lecture. So it starts with a database with information, then we build a corpus. A corpus is in essence a set of documents. Then we transform these documents into data that we can somehow process. And then we feed it to, let's say, many of the data science techniques that we have seen before. So for example, once we have converted documents into vectors, we can, for example, use neural networks to, for example, automatically classify documents or something similar. So that is the pipeline that we will focus on. And the word text mining is let's say, very broad and is linking to all kinds of other topics. So, for example, at the end of this lecture, I will also talk about things like the semantic web, WordNet, and these types of things. So it is on the one hand very broad, and on the other hand also specific. It, of course, relates to information retrieval and natural language processing. I think everybody has a basic idea of what information retrieval is. That is the problem that you have a large collection of documents. Let me switch on my pointers. And so we have a large collection of documents, for example, the World Wide Web. A user has a query, and from this large collection of documents, you would like to find the documents that are relevant given the query. This is the topic of information retrieval, and it has many, let's say, connections to the field of data science and text mining. NLP can be seen, but many definitions exist, but NLP can be seen as a subfield that focuses on machine learning techniques to extract meaning from textual information. Computational linguistics is another term that you sometimes hear, and that is in essence the same as NLP, so natural language processing. And these fields in themselves are very broad. The topic of text mining is also something that has already a long history. So analyzing text, trying to use computers to automatically process text is of course something that is already, that has been around for many years. I think a very nice illustration of that is, let's say, trying to break the Enigma encoding scheme during the Second World War. I think most of you have heard of that and have seen that. So this, let's say, in the war, let's say, encoding was used. So you would kind of translate a text composed of letters into a different text, again with letters. And the idea would be that nobody would be able to read this text. If you have such a, let's say, conversion, then you try to decipher this. And one of the key elements in breaking, let's say, this encoding was using, let's say, the fact that certain terms and certain words have a certain frequency in a language. And so, for example, the letter E is appearing much more frequent than, I don't know, the letter X. So this way you can exploit these things to try to break, let's say, an encoding. And this was already a form. These were the first computers that existed, let's say, in the world that were already, let's say, used on textual data. There are many text mining applications. They can again be split into supervised and unsupervised. For example, an example of supervised learning would be, okay, we now would like to know whether a tweet is angry or not, like in sentiment analysis. So we look for a specific target feature of a document. It can be unsupervised, so we just have a collection of 1 million documents and we would like to structure them using clustering. These text mining applications, of course, text is always in a specific language, German, English, Chinese, whatever. And these text mining applications can be language dependent. For example, automatic translation from English into German. It can also be language independent. So these are techniques that, so for example, finding keywords where it is not that relevant what the language is that is being used. So I just sketch a bunch of examples before we go into, let's say, more, let's say, technical details. So one application is document clustering. So we have a large set of documents and here we can do, let's say, hierarchical clustering, exactly as you have seen it in the lectures before, to cluster the documents. We can try to classify documents. So we have documents and we would like to decide, okay, is this now a sports document or not? Is this a fashion article or not? So that's a supervised learning problem. Another challenge that you typically need to address if you're processing text is that you need to recognize what, let's say, certain terms mean. So named entity recognition, as is illustrated here, refers to the ability that if you have, let's say, text, that you're able to have an idea what something is. So for example, named entity recognition can be used to identify what are persons in a piece of text? Or what are locations? Or what are organizations? And it's indicated in blue. Part of speech tagging is similar, but it focuses on, let's say, linguistic concepts like verbs, nouns, etc. So here we have an analysis of the sentence, the little yellow dog barked at the cat. And this sentence is annotated in different parts. And so, for example, barked is a verb. We have nouns like a dog. We have adjectives like little and yellow, etc., etc. And so in these tables, you can see what these symbols mean. This is not the topic of, let's say, this lecture, but you have an idea that it is important to know that in a sentence that a particular word is a verb or not. So that's part of speech tagging, basically parsing the sentence and adding the corresponding type. So there are these different types of words that exist. And here you can see, let's say, a longer sentence where all the things are mapped onto to the different linguistic concepts that exist. But that is just, let's say, the tip of the iceberg. There are much more tricky problems. For example, what do things refer to in a sentence? And we will come back to that later. And that's, of course, very important to understand what the semantics of a sentence is. So in this sentence, for example, he is referring to neither. She at the end is referring to my, is referring to I at the beginning. So we are able to relate these different words that they refer to the same person in this example. But it could also be a machine or another type of object. An application is sentiment analysis. I briefly mentioned that before. So you could, for example, look at tweets, you could look at emails, you could look at news articles, and you would like to classify, let's say, the emotion behind such a tweet or article. And then, there are techniques. This is a supervised learning problem. You can basically do that by training, for example, a neural network on these emotional criteria. And then you, after that, you've trained such a neural network, you can basically classify tweets in a particular way. Of course, a nice example would be the tweets of Donald Trump. So there have been, let's say, several research papers on analyzing Trump's tweets, and of course this is a nice application for sentiment analysis. Then there is keyword extraction. The language contains, and I will come back to that extensively, contains many things that are not so relevant. So D, A, for, to, these are all words that will appear in any document. So there is no point in, for example, trying to classify a document based on words that appear in any document. Also, if we are extracting keywords, we are of course interested in the words that really tell something about the underlying document. Machine translation. I think most of you have seen that works pretty well today. That's another example of in the field of NLP and text mining, where we have sentences, we try to capture what they mean, and then we try to convert that to another language. Here you can see like an illustration that these things work today, let's say, reasonably well. So here I started with the text in English, and I'm showing the German and the Dutch translation. And it's far from perfect, but it is somehow usable already. And of course, this will improve in coming years. So text mining is a very broad topic. I just sketched a bit the spectrum of things. I could have lectures on sentiment analysis, etc., etc. I do not do that because you would find these types of topics in a dedicated course on text mining. In this first lecture, we will start with the basics, looking at mostly at the representation of data and the pre-processing of it. So we now start to slowly talk about the pre-processing of text in order to apply the various supervised and unsupervised learning techniques that we had seen before. So the focus will be on this middle part that is highlighted on this slide. Yeah, and the idea is, and I think you already get that after this first lecture, that once you have done that, you have representations and you can use these representations in conjunction with the techniques that we have seen before. So for example, if we are able to translate every document to a feature vector, then I think all of you understand that once we have such a feature vector, we can do clustering and many other things. And I'm just going back to the slide that I showed already in previous lectures. We focus here on the pre-processing of text. And after having done that, we can use many of the things that we have seen before. Okay, let's start talking about text process pre-processing, as I mentioned. So text is in principle unstructured. It's not that there should be a fixed number of words, or words should be taken from a fixed small set of things. It's also unclear what the so it's unclear what the instances are, and it is unclear what the features are. And for many of the, let's say, classical problems that we looked at, that was very clear. We had the columns corresponded to the different features, and the rows were corresponding to the different instances. If we are dealing with text, the question, what is this? So text is unstructured. What do we consider? We have words, we have letters, we have sentences. Sentences are in documents, documents are in collections of documents. So what is the scope that we consider? The length of a unit of text may vary dramatically. So we may have articles of 4 pages, but we may also have articles of 100 pages. And it is not so clear what the text features are. And these are the things that we will answer in this lecture. So we need to pre-process the text, and I'm going to talk about the problems that you encounter when making the text ready to apply all of these data science techniques. So the first question, I already mentioned that. What is the scope of the things that we do? So here I'm going to structure the problem a bit, and you could still then interpret things in a different way. But the way that we view it is we have a corpus that is composed of a set of documents, and this set of documents is composed of words, and words are grouped into sentences. That's the basic structure that we will take, but in a way this is arbitrary. So if you look at Twitter data, then probably our corpus would be a collection of tweets, and every tweet would be a document. So we have a corpus that is the, let's say, first level of structuredness that we somehow restrict our attention. Note that the world is, let's say, overloaded with text documents. So we always, when we do something with text, we always need to choose a particular scope if we want to do something. So we first need to scope it, and scoping leads to the identification of a corpus, and the corpus is further structured into documents. And that's what is on this slide. And there may be metadata. Ideally, if we look at the corpus, it is in the same language, because otherwise things are very, let's say, incomparable. but this is a principle open. So we have a corpus, and a corpus is composed of documents. When I say the word document, you have an intuitive meaning with what it is, but this could be, let's say, as short as a tweet, or it could be an entire book. Such a corpus is then decomposed into documents, and these documents are consisting of, let's say, text, and typically these things have been annotated by hand, both at the document level and also at the level of, let's say, the words inside such a document. So for example, if you earlier I explained what named entity recognition is, and that when words or sub-sentences appear in a text, that you say what they represent. And here you see, for example, some example annotations. And these annotations are very important to do certain things with such documents. So lots of the text mining field heavily relies on humans annotating pieces of text. And ideally, these efforts can be reused also for documents that have not been annotated yet. And so, for example, here you see an annotation at the word level. So here you see three words in Arabic. And then they are tagged with different properties. So, for example, N stands for noun, V stands for verb. Then there are different types of nouns, and there are different types of verbs, and words can be female or male. And so here we have words, we are tagging them with these properties, and if we have done that, then we can reuse that later, independent in which document these words are being used. That is what we would like to do. And we need to pre-process that, because there are many issues, let's say, trying to do this. The pre-processing that I will explain will consist of, let's say, in first instance, of three steps: tokenization, stop word removal, and token normalization. So tokenization means that we decide, okay, a document is composed of something. What are the units, let's say, inside a document? Typically these will be words. Then many of these tokens carry no information, or carry only confusing information. We would like to remove them. That's stop word removal. And there is the problem that there can be different words that actually refer to the same concept. And there, let's say, there are, later we will talk about more sophisticated techniques, but initially we will look at stemming and lemmatization. Okay, tokenization, that is how we split a document. So again, a corpus consists of documents, and every document consists of tokens. Usually, as is said here, these tokens correspond to words, but that is not necessary, that is not strictly necessary. We could also look at lower level structures like characters. But we identify tokens, so a document is now composed of a sequence of tokens. That's the basic idea. So this is easy, you think at first sight. When does the next word start? You could say, okay, that is when in a sentence there is a space. And if you do that, I could take a look at this sentence that we can all read. So this is a sentence, and now I'm going to identify what the tokens is, and I cut this sentence into tokens. So in this example, a sentence is a document, as I explained it before. So we transform the document into tokens, and basically, at every space, a new token starts. And if I do that, then you immediately see what the problem is. And so I've applied some algorithm on this that breaks the document into tokens each time there is a space. And so you can write such a function yourself in let's say 5 minutes, and then it will return this. But the question is, are we now happy? If you look at first sight, it looks reasonable, but then if you look deeper, it is not. And so there is no space here, but we all know that this actually means he is. So this should be two tokens, using the philosophy that we also used in the rest. Then there is this name consisting of three words. The same holds for, let's say, New York City. They refer to the same concept, either a name or a city. There are these punctuations that are not separated by spaces. So you already see that if we break a document down into tokens, that things get tricky. Depending on the language, in some languages, like if you compose words, they still exist as, let's say, individual words. If you look at the German language, that is not the case. So you can kind of make these very long words that refer in a way to different nouns. So for example here, the first part is Lebensversicherung. So Versicherung is already, so insurance, this means life insurance, etc., etc. So it becomes very complicated. There are other examples. This is just funny to see that. So you also see a picture here. So for example, here you have a word of 63 characters. So Rindfleisch Etikettierungsüberwachungsaufgabenübertragungsgesetz. So that's a mouthful. And there are, let's say, many, if you would go to English, this would be many separate words. In Dutch, that's a bit easier for me. This is a very common word, bestuurders aansprakelijkheidsverzekering. So that is driver's liability insurance. So if we now have a sentence that contains words like this, what are now the tokens? So for example, this Dutch word of 40 characters, is that now one token, or should we split it into three tokens? It all depends on the application that you have in mind. And you, depending on what you want to do, you need to make different design decisions. There are also, as we just compared English and German, or English and Dutch, there are differences. But also if you go to, let's say, completely different languages like Chinese, there are subtle differences that do not matter in one language, but are very important in another language. So this is, if we look at these Chinese characters here, then depending on where we put the spaces, the meaning changes completely. How we tokenize these things is somehow very important. So this is showing that tokenization is not trivial, and it highly depends on what you want to do, and it also depends on the language in which the document is written. So that's the first step. We have identified the tokens. Let's just assume that worked all well. That we somehow managed to use rules to break it up in tokens. Then the second step is that we would like to remove the tokens that that are not so meaningful and will only, let's say, hide the actual meaning of a document. So these are words like the, as, in, me, you, which, on, etc. So what you do, if you do a stop word removal, you make a list of tokens that you would like to remove. And here you see an example list. And again, this is highly application dependent. what these lists are. And so in the remainder of this lecture, I will assume that this is my list, and that I'm removing the types of words that we have here. So you may wonder, okay, yeah, this looks very dangerous. If we remove all these words, do we still capture meaning? Is this strictly necessary? Yeah, you need to remove stop words, and I think these two sentences show that very nicely. So these cats, I think everybody agreed that that they mean two completely different things. They are unrelated. Yeah. So if we now try to compare these two sentences by counting the number of identical words, and we did not do any stop word removal, then I can highlight the words that appear in both sentences, so 2 times 2, which were started 2 is appearing in both sentences, etc. So if we look at the both sentences have 10 words, and 6 of these 10 words are the same. So only 4 words are different. And so if you think about two sentences that have like a 60% overlap in words, you're tempted to think, okay, these two sentences are very close to each other. If you look at the sentences, you know that that is not true. So if I now look at of these words, what are now stop words, then all are stop words according to our list, except the ones which started. And so there was a huge overlap, and so 6 out of 10 words were identical, 60% was exactly the same, but if we ignore the stop words, only 1 of these 10 words was actually the same. And so then you would say the overlap is very small. So we are going from 60% overlap to 20% overlap if we remove the stop words. And that is illustrated here. And so now we should compare, we should focus on the green and light blue after removing the red words. And now you can see that the similarity is actually closer to what our intuition would say. So removing stop words is of course crucial if you have mining algorithms that have a vector and you look how often does a word appear, and it is counting the number of times that D appears, and that would have a heavy factor on how we deal with that document. You can imagine that this doesn't work very well. So because algorithms will take into account the frequency, we should somehow get rid of these words that have no meaning, and we will later see also how to do that kind of automatically. But as I said, we kind of look at the stop word list that I indicated before. So we have a stop list, and of course these lists are language dependent. Also, this is again like heavily application and language dependent, depends on the context, and also, for example, we will talk about, let's say, how to cut words to their base meaning. We can have conservative approaches and aggressive approaches. So conservative approaches just remove a smaller percentage of stop words. Aggressive techniques try to remove many words. And please, when I talk about text mining and NLP, do not expect very precise recommendations or very precise techniques. It very much depends on the application, and one cannot give like an objective answer to all of the questions that I'm raising here. And so this lecture is more about making you aware of the problems, and that you see let's say, what are the design choices that one should make. This is illustrating that stop words can be, let's say, context dependent. So for example, working with the corpus extracted from curricula, words such as experience and school do not say anything, because they will appear in any of the documents. Similarly, if you would look at a healthcare related domain, it could be that words like patient and hospital can be removed because they don't mean anything. At the end of this lecture, we will look at, let's say, identifying candidates for stop words based on the frequency of words. Yeah, so if you have words that appear in any document, then they are not that distinctive. And so we don't need to use them for things like clustering. At the same time, one needs to be very careful, because sometimes in a sentence, things syntactically look like a stop word, but semantically they are not. And so this is a sentence that has a certain meaning. If we now do stop word removal, and we use the list that I highlighted before, then we remove all the things highlighted in red and only the blue part remains. And somehow, by removing the stop words, we lost, let's say, what the actual sentence was about. So all of these things are, let's say, very tricky. They require engineering, they require knowledge of the application domain, and there is no exact, precise answer to any of these questions. So we have all these words. Then we have the next problem, that there may be variations of the same word. So if you look at these sentences, then it's clear that things that are, let's say, syntactically the same, you can say that there is a match. But how do, let's say, computer and computing relate to each other? Are they different or not? So if we now build a vector and we count how often a certain word is appearing in a sentence, after removing stop words, do we count computer and computing as the same thing or as different things? The topic of stemming tries to address this problem by basically chopping off part of the word. So what you see here is that if you have these different words, there are, let's say, a limited number of relatively simple rules deciding on what to cut off a word. So this as is indicated here, this works most of the time. So for example, compute, computer, computers, computing, computational, using stemming could also be all be reduced to compute. And then all of these things would be mapped onto the same, let's say, feature. This works most of the time. What you see is that a stem, so what remains after stemming is called a stem. It does not need to be an official word, as you can see here. And the idea is that the root of the word, so this stem, captures the meaning of the word. These techniques can be, just like stop word removal, they can be aggressive in the sense that they want to chop off, let's say, lots of words, or they can be conservative, that they do not want to, let's say, map two different words onto the same word, although they have nothing in common. This is very similar to stop word removal. You can be aggressive, or you can be conservative. And so these aggressive stemmers, they want to find, let's say, similarities between documents. Conservative stemmers are afraid to kind of lose subtle differences between documents. When you go online and you look for software and you look for papers, you will find, let's say, various stemming algorithms that automatically do this. And here I've listed three. So Porter was developed one of the first techniques that led into the snowball stemmer. The Lancaster stemmer is something that is being more aggressive. So more words map onto the same stem. These are available in various languages. So if you go to this website, I can take a piece of text that I wrote, and I can map this piece of text onto, let's say, the text that remains after stemming. So stemming is basically chopping off the last part of the word. But the word that remains does not need to be an official word. Lemmatization works different. You can kind of look at it that you would take a dictionary and that you try to reduce it to the, let's say, core dictionary form where you would look it up. So for example, if I take the verb walk, there's walk, walking, walked, etc., etc., and you try to all of these things correspond actually to the same verb. So when you do something like that, of course you can also do that with nouns, similar things, and that you the base form, you call that a lemma. So if we take the examples that we had before, and so using stemming, we were chopping off the last part and we ended up with this non-existing word. If we look at this, then it would be mapped onto compute. So this is more sophisticated than stemming. Lemmatization tries to identify the base forms of all of these words. And also there are various, let's say, techniques to do that. This is more refined, and here you can look at a piece of text, the same piece of text that I took, and I look at the mapping. So here you see some examples. I will also show the text that I just showed to also compare the difference between stemming and lemmatization. So here you can see that if we chop off the last part, then police and policy become the same thing with stemming. And that is, of course, nonsense, right? Because they refer to two completely different concepts. Lemmatization is, of course, limited by the ability to map things onto common things, and it all depends whether there is the ability to do so. So that is typically less aggressive, but that means that it may be impossible to map things that are actually the same onto the same lemma. So this shows the text that I showed earlier. So you, for example, see that in the original sentence, it was process mining is becoming, and then you see here is become, and here you see be becoming. So this is the lemma is be, is just remain, because nothing could be chopped off. Become is, of course, not like a word. So basically the last part was chopped off. Here, this is still a verb. Country, you can see it here on this side, and you can see that that it is translated in this way here, etc., etc. As I think the differences are clear. The question is, can you now still read these sentences after applying either stemming or lemmatization? What we see is that although these texts may become incomprehensible, if we later feed it to things like neural networks, they are able to do surprising things with this pre-processing text. Stemming and lemmatization can be seen as normalization techniques. You want to have tokens that are syntactically different. If they are semantically the same, you would map them onto the same thing. Of course, this applies to removing punctuation types of things. It also makes sense to convert everything to lowercase. That doesn't make a difference anymore. You may have British and American spelling, like color and with O and color with OU, or modeling with either one L or two L's. And there may also be these words of cities that sometimes it's translated to the language, sometimes not. And of course, you have this translation of certain characters, O umlaut can be converted to that. And sometimes when people are using an editor or a device where they cannot type the umlaut, they will write OA, but they actually mean exactly the same thing. So these are things that we can do, and I think that is pretty clear. Okay, now we get closer to where we want to be. So we have sentences in documents, and we do stop word removal, we do things like lemmatization, and then we would like to translate it into a vector of a fixed length. Okay? Please bear in mind, the goal is to be able to apply the techniques that we had seen before. So if we then use the bag of words, I will come back to that in a minute in more detail, we can basically, in this sentence, we remove the stop words, and then these are the things that remain. So we also applied, we chopped off the last parts of words, for example, checking has become check. And then we also do not consider the order to make it a fixed length representation. And we indicate the frequency of each of these, let's say, remaining tokens in the document, ignoring the order. So this is called the bag of words model, and bag refers to the notion of a multiset that are sometimes called a bag, and we indicate the token frequencies. So all of this is very tricky, and as I said in this lecture, I would really like to make you aware of the difficulties. In the next lecture, we will be much more technical, assuming a certain input, and that all of the things that I've talked about now has been done already. Here in this sentence, you see the word buffalo three times. You as a human understand what this means. So there is a person, there's also a location, etc., etc. So you can understand it, but for a machine, it's very difficult. And so in the previous example, we had buffalo, that in three times in one sentence, and each time buffalo appeared, it meant something different. Of course, there are many examples of homonyms. So these are words that can have completely different meanings. Headache is maybe a sign of stress, but you can also sign a check. Tie, watch, watch like the verb, watch like the noun. Firm, like an organization versus fruit, that is firm, etc., etc. So there are many of such examples, and if you, let's say, study that in more detail, you will actually be surprised how often the same word is used for completely different things, and that you don't even think about it, because it's in the context for a human, it is always completely clear. But of course, for a machine, this is very difficult. If the machine cannot distinguish between the bark, so the outside of a tree, and a dog barking, a dog making sound, you can see that it may lead to very, let's say, odd conclusions if you then apply data science techniques on top of that. But there are many more challenges. In sentences, often there are references. I showed an example at the beginning. And they are, like a few of them are listed here. And so here we have the prepositional attachment. So we have like a phrase, for example, starting with, so with a pair of binoculars. This part refers, is attached to a person. Is it attached to Jen or Kathy? And you as a human know that this with is linked to Kathy. To demonstrate that, so for a human this is clear, but how would the machine know this? To make it clear, so here I have the sentence, eat spaghetti with chopsticks, eat spaghetti with meatballs. And now we focus on the part with meatballs or with chopsticks. What does it refer to? If we look at with chopsticks, it refers to eat. It does not refer to spaghetti, because otherwise that would mean that the chopsticks would be in the spaghetti and you would have to eat them. If we look at eat spaghetti with meatballs, then this with meatballs refers to the spaghetti, right? That is the dish that the person is eating. There are many of such, let's say, linking uncertainties that for a human are obvious, but for a machine are incredibly difficult. And so he convinced his roommate to buy a TV for himself. So now the question is, where does himself refer to? It doesn't refer to he, it refers to the roommate. And so you know that. There are also, let's say, phrases that by stating something, there is an implication that could be used when you're applying data mining techniques, but that is implicit. And so in the sentence, he quit smoking, we gain the knowledge that the person was smoking before. So these are, let's say, many of the challenges. What is really, really surprising is that if you apply, let's say, reasonably crude methods to text, that sometimes it works surprisingly well. That is, and we will see some examples of that. So we are now coming, we have now done the pre-processing. So assume that we have solved all the problems. So we have a corpus, and the corpus consists of documents, and each document consists of tokens. And we have done all the things that were necessary, and now we would like to start with the modeling. What is a bit confusing in the field of data science is that how the words model and modeling are being used. Sometimes the model is the thing that comes out. So you could think of a decision tree or a process model as a model. And sometimes it refers to the process of, let's say, engineering the learning technique. For example, setting parameters, deciding what the representation is, etc., etc., as the modeling. So sometimes it's more about the process of coming to some kind of artifact like a decision tree, and sometimes it is used for the artifact itself. So I will be sloppy when I use this term, but it should be clear what I mean. So we want to work towards the bag of words model as a starting point. So the bag of words model represents each document in the corpus as a bag of tokens. Tokens correspond to words in this setting, and the word bag refers to the notion of a multiset. So here I can formalize this. Note that when I'm using words in this setting, these words actually correspond to the remaining tokens after doing all the pre-processing. But because they often are words, that is easier. It's common to call it like that. So W is the set of possible words. Then a document is a multi-set of words. Note that we know how frequent each word appears in the document, but we do not know the order, because that's now the abstraction that we have chosen. D is equal to the multiset over W is the set of all possible documents. And so these are basically now, and so every document is like a vector indicating how frequent each word appears. And a corpus can be seen as a multiset of documents. And so D is equal to that. So now we have a multiset of words. Why is there a multiset here? We are using a multiset here because in principle, I don't know, two tweets could be completely identical. Now, although they are different, the text is exactly the same. And that's why you can think of them as a multiset of a multiset of words. That is a corpus C. So if we look at the bag of words model, I already explained it before, but because it's a key concept, I show some more examples. So this is, let's say, a piece of text of a statement made by Rumsfeld about, like in the context of the weapons of destruction. He was saying these nine sentences where he talks about known unknowns, unknown unknowns, etc., etc. If I translate this to using the bag of words model, we get known, unknown, and thing, and many other words that happen only once. So this is an example of the how this works. Of course, there are many sentences that have the same bag of words representation. So these two sentences here, where I basically swapped the role of Kate and Jones, if we look at them through the bag of words view, they are identically. And so their abstraction is exactly the same. The same if we look at these two sentences. Also, if we we use the bag of words model, they map onto the same multiset of tokens. Of course, this becomes problematic when the order of words is incredibly important, and this will be a topic that we will cover, let's say, in a lot of detail in the next section. But here we assume that we have this abstraction. Why is this abstraction working? As I said, sometimes it works surprisingly well. It is easy to implement. It has been successfully applied in all kinds of domains. As I said, later we will look at more refined representations where we are also taking into account the ordering of words. But now, in this lecture, we just use the bag of words after we have done all the pre-processing that I talked about before. So if we do this, then we get a representation that should look very familiar to you. So we can see every document as an instance. So every document is now mapped onto a row. And we can indicate for each word what their frequency is, because we're using the bag of words model. And there could be other attributes, like, for example, a certain target variable, like the article class. If I look at the representation that I just showed to you, you can already imagine that you can use such a representation, for example. If I would look at that, I hope that you immediately see, okay, we can do logistic regression. We can apply support vector machines, we can apply neural networks based on this. And then the goal would be that we would learn a predictor, a model that predicts what the article class is. I think everybody can see that you can use these types of input. If I for a moment forget about the article class and I just look at the vectors indicating the frequency of each word, I think everybody can see that, okay, this can also be used for clustering, for example. So we are getting close to where we want to do, to what we want to be. However, we have the problem that looking at the absolute frequency of a word in a document is not such a good idea. And so documents may vary incredibly in length, and it could be that there could be words that are super frequent, but that appear in almost any document in the corpus that we are considering. That is why we compute two metrics that we combine. The first is term frequency, and term frequency of a word in a document, as a W refers to a word or a token, and D refers to a document. This expression simply counts how often does that word appear in that document. And so super simple. So here I took, let's say, an older version of my CV, and I apply, let's say, I compute this TF function, and if I do that, I see that, for example, the word "and" is appearing 8 times, and my first name is appearing twice. So you already immediately see that the problem, the fact that things like and the are frequent, and if we did not remove them already using when we were considering stop words, they have a relatively high weight. And like my first name has a relatively low weight. So because the absolute frequency does not say everything, we also look at the inverse document frequency. And this refers to how specific is a word in a certain collection of documents, so in a particular corpus. So the formula is as follows. So if we look at the inverse document frequency of a word W in the context of some corpus that consists of n documents, then this is the logarithm of n divided by the number of documents that contain W at least once. So what is the maximal number of documents that may contain this word W? That can be only be n. Yeah, so it can be that we have n divided by n, and that is equal to 1, and if we take the logarithm of that, it's equal to 0. If we now have a large number of documents, so let's say n is 1,000 or 10,000, and we look at the word and the word appears only in, let's say, 10 of these 10,000 documents, then we have 10,000 divided by 10, and then we take the logarithm, so then we have a higher number. And so the more rare a word is, the higher the inverse document frequency gets. So the intuitive notion that you should have is that this term, and so n divided by this, I can basically take 1 divided by the number of documents that contain W at least once divided by n. And if you write it like that, then you realize that this actually corresponds to this, where you can interpret PW as the probability that the word appears. So PW in this equation correspond to the number of documents that contain W divided by the overall number of documents. And that these two terms are then, of course, exactly the same. We are using the inverse of this as an estimator for the probability that a word W is present in a random document in our corpus. So that is the intuitive notion, just like a number example to help you a bit. So this is based on an imaginary collection of newspaper articles where we look at these three words So Merkel, Seehofer and Scholz, and we look how frequent they are. So there are 100 newspaper articles, and we divide it by the number of news articles where a particular name appears. So if Merkel appears in all of these 100 documents, then this is equal to zero. So it carries no information. It doesn't make the document special in any way. If we look at the IDF of Seehofer, then he is appearing in 10 out of these 100 articles. Then we have this. And if Scholz is only appearing in one of these 100 documents, then it has a IDF of 6.6. So now we have two forces. We have one force that looks, okay, if a certain word is highly frequent in a document, it must be very important for that document and very characteristic. But if it also appears in many other documents, then it becomes less important. So we are now simply going to multiply the two things that we just had. So this is summarizing a bit what I just said. And so words with a low IDF score appear in many documents. If it appears in every document, then the score is even equal to zero. And that means that these words are not useful to distinguish between documents. You can use this as an approach to identify stop words. In the text that I showed earlier, we could see that D was the most frequent word. So if D is appearing in every document, then it will automatically have an IDF score equal to zero, right? And we could all the words or all the tokens that have an IDF score close to zero, we could add them to the stop list and remove them because they carry no information. As I said, we would like to combine these two forces that we have, and this is called the TF-IDF score. So the TF-IDF score of a word and a document in the context of a particular corpus is TF. So how many times does the word W appear in document D times IDFW. And remember that IDFW is equal to zero if the word appears in any document, and this value becomes higher if the word is more rare, because it's the logarithm of one divided by its probability. And this combination seems to be a good combination. Like many things, let's say, in the setting of text mining, is that it is all a bit vague. And you could ask, okay, why do you take the logarithm here and not something else? But this is based on experience. But there is no logical reasoning why this would be the best measure and one could not take something else. Just to illustrate the principle a bit, suppose that we look at this word, right? And I'm assuming that we are also doing the pre-processing a bit on the fly. So now we are interested in the TF-IDF score of this word feline. Then we look at, okay, where does it appear? And in this document, so the focus is now on this document, it appears once, and it doesn't appear in any of the other documents. So the TF score is once, one, because in the document that we look at, it appears precisely once. And then we multiply this by the IDF score of this word, and the word is, there are four documents, and it's only appearing in one of them. And so we get a logarithm of 4 is equal to 2. So the TF-IDF score is 1 times 2 is 2. Now we look at the word cat. as another example. So we look at the word cat and we now look at this document. So if we look at what are the documents where cats is appearing, that is in the top two, and in both of these documents is occurring once. Our focus is here, so the TF score is equal to 1. The IDF score, we basically look at all the documents, there are 4 of them, divided by the number of documents that contain cat in some way, and that leads to an IDF score equal to 1. Yeah, so we take the logarithm of 2 is equal to 1. And then we do the TF-IDF score of cat in this document is equal to 1. Now I look at pet, but I think you get the idea. Pet is appearing once in this document. It is appearing in 3 documents. So its TF-IDF score is 0.41. So both cat and pet appeared once, but you can see that the TF-IDF score is here 0.41, and in the previous setting it was equal to 1. So we see that it is dropping because the word pet is appearing in more documents, which is the effect that we would like to have. Here's an example of a text where, let's say, the same word or the same token is appearing twice. So note that we are doing stemming. So we look at dog. Dog appears twice in this piece of text. We would now like to compute the TF-IDF score for this document and the token dog. Then the TF is equal to 2 because it is appearing twice in this document. And the IDF score, and then we look at 4 divided by all the documents that contain the word dog, and there are 3 of them. So we get this score, and the TF-IDF score is the number that we get by multiplying these 2 values. So this hopefully gives an idea of how to score these things. It is super simple, but these are the things that can be used, for example, in querying. These are the things that we can do to pre-process our data, to apply any of the data science techniques that we have looked at before. So here is the example of information retrieval. So we have a query. The query is just, let's say, a bag of words. And we have a corpus. And the corpus is a set of documents, and every document is represented by a bag of words. And then we can compare the query with respect to each document. And so the query is a bag of words. D is a particular document, so that's also a bag of words. And what we do is that we sum over W, that's our query, and then we compute the sum over summing up all the TF-IDF values of all the words in the query over that document. And note that this TF-IDF computation is taking into account how rare this word W is. So it has like if there is a search term in the query that is a word that is very infrequent, and it appears many times in a certain document, then it will get a very high score because of that word. So we sum that. Like what the absolute value is not so important, because we can simply rank the documents based on this score, and we can return the first n documents. So using this principle, you can build your own, let's say, primitive search engine based on just looking at the text itself and not at the links. So we already had a document term matrix illustration before, but before we were considering the numbers for every instance, and an instance corresponds to a document. The numbers were indicating the absolute frequency of a word in a particular document. So here every column is a word, every row is a document, so an instance. And before we were just considering the absolute number, we can now replace this absolute number by the TF-IDF score. And that typically works much better, because we rare words that happen frequent somehow have a bigger weight. So this is what we showed before. So now these numbers that are here could either refer to the absolute number of a word appearing in a document, or it could be based on the TF-IDF score. In both cases, what we get is a vector. And if every document also has a label, like a target feature, and the target feature is called here article class, then we can generate supervised learning problems. So what we often see is that the same document, so the same instance, can have different types of target features, and we can generate different, let's say, supervised learning problems based on the different target features. As I mentioned, it's better to use TF-IDF values in such a matrix rather than the absolute frequency. And this is what I just said, is that through these transformations, we get the problems that we have been looking at before. So if we do not have, let's say, target features, clearly identified target features, and just, let's say, the TF-IDF scores for every document word combination, then we can use something like this, for example, for clustering. So we can just use things like k-means, k-medoids, hierarchical clustering. We can do all of the things that we had seen before. If we have, let's say, target features, then for each target feature we can generate a supervised learning problem. So we just pick a target feature, for example F1, and then we have a supervised learning problem. So we can use decision trees, we can use logistic regression, depending on the so whether the target feature is categorical or numerical, we may use normal regression or logistic regression. If it's categorical, we can also use, let's say, support vector machines. And in both cases, we can apply neural networks. And so this is the bridge with all kinds of techniques that you have seen already before. So we can use it for clustering. If we look at clustering, then we need to, of course, look at distance measures. In principle, you can apply anything that I had showed to you before. If you're using, specifically if you're using, let's say, the frequencies of words instead of the TF-IDF score, then if I have a document that has twice as many words as another document, it becomes a bit tricky to compare them. Because if you think of that in terms of a vector, then I have two vectors that are in principle pointing into the same direction, but because one document is twice as long as another document, the vector is twice as long. So there would be a big difference if we would just use things like the Euclidean distance between these vectors. So that's why in the context of text mining, we often use the cosine similarity, and you have seen this notion before. And so this leads to, and so this metric, if I have two vectors each representing a document and they point into exactly the same direction, then they have a similarity of one. If they are, let's say, completely orthogonal, if we look at their vector representation, then it's zero. If they're pointing completely in opposite directions, then it would be minus 1. And whether that is possible depends a bit on the representation that you have. So that's why cosine similarity is better suited than, for example, Euclidean distance or Manhattan distance. But these are all things that you have seen before, and I'm convinced that you can now see how this immediately can be fed into any clustering technique, because you have the vector representation and you can pick different distance notions. So what we have seen so far, we have seen that we can, from text, generate supervised and unsupervised learning problems. We have seen that in the mapping that we did is that we have a corpus that consists of documents. The documents are instances, and then we have words, and the words can be considered as features. And there is lots of pre-processing needed to ensure that the collection of words, the collection of tokens that we have, is the right one. And that's what I've explained so far. But we are not there yet. We are still have difficulties capturing the semantics of what documents contain and what they mean. And so we have seen that different words can mean the same thing, but also that the same word can mean different things. So you could try to annotate all these pieces of text, but many of these things are reusable. So this is where semantics come in, and things like the semantic web play an important role. So there are, we see a movement towards having databases that are not just storing the syntax, but that are also storing in some way the semantics and the connections between things. And this is what I would like to talk about, let's say, at the end of this lecture. So an example of, let's say, attempts into this direction is WordNet. It's very famous. So WordNet is a lexical network that contains many words. Similar things can be found in other languages. And the words are grouped into, let's say, syn sets. And these are sets of, let's say, meanings of words that are somehow semantically equivalent. And so you try to bring words that can have a similar meaning together into a particular set. And then you try to establish, let's say, relationships between these different sets and the different words. So there are relationships that say that there is an antonym, so that things have an opposite meaning: cold versus warm, high versus low, big versus small. You also have the is-a relationship, so you can have hyponyms, so daisy and rose are types of flowers. But you could also say, I don't know, that a Porsche and a BMW are cars. And so you can express such relationships. They are all there in WordNet. And you can also indicate things that are not, let's say, specializations, like an is-are relationship, but there are part-of relationships. And so that the car is composed of an engine, wheels, etc., etc. So in such a lexical network, you can basically store these relationships. Here there is an impression. So here you see a graph at a higher level. On the right-hand side, you can see, for example, the different meanings that the word process can have. So it can be a noun, it can be a verb, but also within noun and verb, it is referring to different syn sets. And again, the syn sets try to capture the semantics of things. So these are all attempts of storing the semantics of words with all the problems that I indicated before. And you can organize them in networks, and WordNet was already an example of that. And the connections between these words can again have a meaning. And so before in WordNet, there's a fixed meaning, like two things mean the opposite, or two things mean that there is one is a specialization of the other. But in principle, you can also define your own relationships. And this is where you end up with representations like, for example, RDF. So RDF, you can think of it as a super general data model that describes relationships between things using a fixed triple structure. So you that is linking a subject to an object through a predicate. And it's important to realize, the way that we will talk about this later, you can think of the subject as a kind of URL. So it's called an RDF URI, but think of it as a URL pointing to some website. Then there is a predicate. The predicate also has such a reference. And then there is the object, and the object can also be a reference, like a URI, or it can be a literal. So for example, a subject could be will, the predicate could be age, and then the object could be, for example, a literal like my age. So just to provide some examples in RDF, these are two RDF triples that are expressing that this person is the Secretary General of the UN and Berlin is located in Germany. And so these are these triples that you normally show graphically. Here you see a whole network, and then you can see why people talk about things like the semantic web and often use terms that talk about graphs and nets. Here you, for example, see an RDF graph about artists, songs, etc. So the things that are in blue are, let's say, things that play the role as a subject or an object that has, but they have in common that the blue nodes have a so-called RDF URI reference. So they are unique entities represented by such a URI. The green nodes, they always play the role of being an object, and they are represented by a literal. So also, for example, song here is also playing the role of an object in this relationship, but it is a URI. While this title of the song is a literal. And so you have pointers and values. And this is super simple, but there are all kinds of query languages over such graphs. And they allow you to, let's say, automatically answer questions like the ones that I see here. And they are basically answered by, let's say, doing queries over such, let's say, an RDF graph. So these URIs play an important role. They are unique identifiers. They can just mean one thing. It cannot be like the word process that we had before, that it can have like 10 different meanings. No, URIs are unique. They refer to something that is unambiguous. So there is a one-to-one correspondence between the URI and what it represents. And so it cannot be that there are two different things that have the same URI, or that like the things have multiple URIs. And so there's a one-to-one connection. And so for some domains, this is very simple. So for example, if you look at books, They have an ISBN number, and you can think of that as the unique identifier for such a book. If you're studying here at the university, then your student number is another example of a URI. We of course want to do this for all entities in such a way that we can reason about this. Partly this is already exists and is there, and the idea of, let's say, this part of my lecture is, if you are doing text mining, to use the combination of, let's say, resources that are already available and this unstructured text. And this is a very powerful combination, and we are still at the beginning of seeing the development of that. So if you look at Wikipedia, then article entries in Wikipedia can be seen as URIs. And here I'm using the same example as the RDF triples that I showed earlier. So here you can see the triple that we had seen before, but now I the URIs refer to Wikipedia pages. Of course, Wikipedia has the problem that it was not made for machines and made for reasoning, but it was designed by humans for humans. That is why, although it is a very good starting point for, let's say, general purpose knowledge, there are, let's say, variants of the idea of Wikipedia that are more intended for robots. So DBpedia is like a similar initiative, but then organized in terms of RDF triples and intended for robots that reason over such networks. So here indeed, here you see a fragment of this. As I said, it looks the same as Wikipedia in a way, but let's say these links and the objects have now these URIs in such a way that one can reason over this. So the idea of linked open data is to exploit the fact that there are, let's say, multiple sources of such information. So Wikipedia is one, but there are many, let's say, sources of information that once you can connect them, they are very powerful. And the key element in making this work is that somehow these URIs are maintained over these multiple databases. And that is the challenge, that if I have a Wikipedia representation or a DBpedia representation, and I have an internal SAP system, that I can somehow connect them to each other. And this is the idea of linked open data. So this is providing data that is publicly available, that you basically can reuse. And why is this in this lecture on text mining? It is in this lecture on text mining because if we look at the words in a text, they are in principle pointing to things in the space that you see here. And in the future, we will see much more, let's say, semantically annotated information sources. So in this lecture, we gave like a first initial introduction to text mining. We spent a lot of time on text pre-processing. As I indicated, this is not something where you can say, okay, it has to be done exactly in this way. We highlighted many problems that can be addressed, but there is no optimal solution. And that's why you always have to realize that you are working with things that are, let's say, not 100% deterministic. But as I also indicated, they work surprisingly well. So for example, if we are doing information retrieval on a large set of documents and we use the bag of words model combined with TF-IDF scoring, we get the documents that we are after. So it simply works despite, let's say, all the subtle factors that we have. What we have seen is that using the back of words model, we can represent things in terms of a feature vector, and that means that we can apply all the techniques that we have seen before. At the end, I talk more about semantics, and that the words that we consider in text mining actually refer to concepts, and if we can link words to these concepts, then that is a very powerful combination. But it depends on the application. So the bag of words model, as I already indicated, is basically ignoring the order of words. There is also the problem that if we look at the number of words that can appear in a document, the number of potential words is huge. And so we are, on the one hand, we have the bag of words representation is very big, because there are many possible words. We have huge vectors, because the size of the vector is the number of different tokens, or the number of different words that we consider. So that can be huge, but at the same time, these vectors may be very sparse, and there may be words that appear in less than 1% of the documents. So most of the entries will be zero. And then there is the semantical problem that we talked about. Okay, how do we now capture the meaning of these things? So we will address these problems that I'm highlighting here, and also make, let's say, a much stronger connection, for example, to how does this relate to the lecture on neural networks. So, for example, first in the lecture, in the next lecture, we will first talk about simple things like that capture order, like n-grams. And then we go into autoencoders, word2vec, doc2vec, and all of these things that are basically combining the different ingredients that we have seen before. Okay, so this was the first lecture on text mining. The next lecture will continue on this, as I just indicated. What then still remains in this course is that we will talk in much more detail about data pre-processing and visualization. We did this in the second lecture, but we will now go much deeper. Then there will be two lectures related to responsible data science. There we specifically will look at things like privacy and how we can protect that using certain algorithms. We will also look at the notion of fairness, how we avoid that, let's say, our data science techniques are somehow discriminating based on the data that they are using. So we will look at techniques that we can automatically compensate that for that. And so, for example, techniques like fair data mining, fair machine learning, these types of things. What is not in this table, but that will be later, are things related to big data, and then we can come to a conclusion of the course. See you next time.